Good morning, everybody. I'm Marco Nobile. I'm a postdoc researcher at the University of Milano Bicocca. I want to thank Jorge Piras for the kind invitation to this workshop. And the title of my presentation is Evolutionary and Solar Intelligence Methods for Systems Biology. This is the outline of my talk. I will start by describing what reaction-based modeling is and the role of kinetic parameters. I will then describe the problem of parameter estimation, and I will discuss how computational intelligence can be leveraged to solve the problem of parameter estimation. Then I will discuss why we wanted to implement a settings-free version of one of the computational intelligence methods used for this problem, and then I will describe how we use GPUs to mitigate the huge computational effort required by these methodologies. So, there are three main modeling methodologies in systems biology. The first one is the interaction-based modeling. And in interaction-based modeling, we have a network, a graph, and the nodes of the graph are the proteins, the actors of the cell. Two nodes in this graph are connected by an edge when these two actors are known to interact. For instance, two proteins that are interacting. Naturally, we can go on a large scale with this kind of modeling. We can leverage omics data to automatically create these models. But the problem is that this kind of description is purely qualitative and it's static, so there is no notion of time. The system is freezed and we cannot perform a natural simulation. And if we add some constraints to this kind of modeling approaches, then we have constant-based modeling, for instance, flux balance analysis. So in this case, we have some boundaries for the possible fluxes in the system, and then we can have a semi-quantitative description of the system. Naturally, we are assuming a steady-state situation, so we have no notion of time. We cannot perform an actual simulation. We can just investigate the distribution of fluxes in a specific condition. And then we have mechanism-based models, which are very, very smaller than the previous model that I described. But in this time, we have a very detailed biochemical and molecular information. So we can go fully dynamic, we can perform simulations that are fully quantitative. And the problem is that in order to make these models, in order to build such models, we need a full parameterization of the system. So why do we want to use dynamic modeling? Well, because they allow us to achieve a detailed comprehension of the cellular processes. And one example of this kind of approach is reaction-based modeling. In reaction-based modeling, we have a set of reactions that involve a set of chemical species. And we have an information about the how these chemical species are converted into other chemical species with a specific stoichiometry, so the specific number of molecules involved in each reaction. So we have a set of reactions like this, and each reaction has a number associated to it, which is called the kinetic parameter, which ultimately determines the rate of the reaction. So we need all this information and also the initial amounts of the system in order to perform a simulation. And the most delicate problem is that we need a full vector of parameters k, which contains all the kinetic parameters of the reactions, in order to perform a simulation. Why? Because they ultimately drive the dynamic behavior of the system. So if we slightly change a parameter, we can dramatically change the dynamic behavior of the system. Let me do a simple example of this. So let's assume a Bruscillator, which is a very simple, minimal example of oscillating chemical system. We are talking about a system with four reactions and four chemical species, like this. So let's assume this initial condition, so 200 molecules of A, 200 molecules of X, 600 molecules of B, and 300 molecules of Y. If we use the nominal values in the nominal kinetic parameters, then this is an example of simulation of the Bruscillator. We have wide oscillations, and they repeat in time. Well, what happens if we change, for instance, the parameter K3 a little bit? This is what happens. As you can see, we have a completely different dynamic behavior from a quantitative and a qualitative point of view. It's not just the randomness, it's that we completely changed the oscillations of the system. And now we can try to go back and change the parameter number 4, and this is what happens. We completely lost the oscillations in the system, we just have some random noise, and the two molecules reach a steady state and they never move from there. So we need a specific parameterization in our model if we want to perform faithful, useful, meaningful simulation of our system. And naturally, we can see that we have a problem if we don't have these parameters, because they might be impossible or way too expensive to calculate using laboratory experiments. We need to create some automatic methodology to obtain such parameters. And this problem can be restated as an optimization problem. We can see that we have a simulation and we want to see how far our simulation is from the expected behavior. So we, in a laboratory, we collect the time series of our system, and then we try to determine how far we are from the expected behavior. That is, we are converting the problem into a minimization problem. We want to minimize the difference between the expected behavior and the simulation. So there are three main classes of parameter estimation methodology based on what I just said. The first one is the class of probabilistic methods, in which the goal is to maximize the likelihood of data with respect to the parameterization. Naturally, these kind of approaches are used in the context of stochastic optimization, and the problem is that they require a huge amount of simulation in order to assess the likelihood of data. The second approach is called evolutionary computation, and the idea is to create a population of random solutions, and this population undergoes a process of simulated evolution. So we have selection, crossover, and mutation. One classic example is differential evolution. And then the third class of parameter estimation methods is form intelligence. So it's similar to evolutionary computation. Again, we start from a population of random solutions, but instead of using evolution, we use the emergent behavior of a group of animals. So in nature, we have frequently that nature solves some very complicated problems by using some emergent intelligence from group of animals. And one example is particle swarm optimization. So do these methodologies, these computational intelligence methodologies, work for the problem of parameter estimation? This is what Dreger and his colleagues investigated some years ago. So they took some 6 models and used state-of-the-art parameter estimation methods to solve the problem and see the performances. So these are the methods that they compared in this work. And what you can see here, the lower the better, is that parameter swarm, particle swarm optimization and differential evolutions are consistently among the best algorithms for the problem, except here in which DE never actually converged to the solution. So yes, the answer is yes, evolution and swarm intelligence work for this problem, and we can leverage that. So how do these methods work? How do the methods that Dreger investigated work? Well, as I said, we start from creating a random population, which is a set of putative solutions for our problem, completely random, and then we begin a cycle in which we evaluate the population, we modify the population in some smart way, then we check the termination criterion, so if we converge or not, if we reach the maximum number of iterations or not, and if not, we repeat the evaluation and repeat the modification and so forth. When we reach the termination criterion, we return the best solution as a solution of our problem. And what really changes across the different algorithms is this step, so how we modify the population. But the first thing that we need to assess is how we evaluate the population, because as I see, we need to evaluate the population during each iteration. So we need to calculate some distance between the simulated behavior and the available target data. Let's assume now that we have some discrete time series of our chemical species. Then we can create a fitness function which assesses the quality of each individual, and it could be implemented like this. So we calculate the distance between the expected behavior here and the simulation of the dynamics using a putative parameterization here, and we normalize the quantity by dividing by the expected behavior, and we accumulate the whole distances for all the chemical species. So we are able to associate a putative parameterization, that is an individual, to a real number which assesses the quality of each individual. Well, now we have a fitness function, and we can use that to evaluate all the individuals in the system, and then we can begin to perform our parameter estimation methodology. The first one that we can consider is differential evolution, which is, as I said, an evolutionary method. DE is based on mutation, recombination, and selection. So we start by initializing the population, then we mutate the population, we recombine the population, and we select the new individuals, and we iterate. Mutation in differential evolution is based on the addition of a vector to a base individual. So we pick up three random solutions, and then we calculate a novel candidate position using this formula here. So we sum up to a random solution the a linear interpolation of the other two solutions. And this value here is called the mutation factor. So there are multiple alternative versions of this mutation mechanism, but basically all consist in this interpolation between individuals. The recombination step is performed afterwards on the putative individual that we created, and we combine the previous structure with a new structure using randomly generated numbers and indices. This value here, which is controlled by the user, is called the crossover ratio, and it determines when we want to recombine the new parameterization using the previous individual or not. Finally, we have a selection mechanism, and basically here is where the fitness evaluation kicks in. So we have a new solution created from the crossover and the mutation, and now we will keep the new solution only if the newly created individual is better than the previous one. In such a case, we replace XY with UI. Genetic algorithms are again an evolutionary methodology which is based on mutation, recombination, and selection, but they are performed in a different fashion with respect to differential evolution. So we begin from the selection, so we evaluate the individuals, and then we select them. And there are three main selection mechanisms: roulette, wheel, ranking, and tournament. There are some more methodologies, but they are not described in this talk. So the first one is roulette wheel, and the selection probability is proportional to the fitness value of the individuals. Then we have the ranking selection, in which the selection probability is proportional to the rank of individuals with respect to the fitness. So we have higher probability for lower fitness individuals to be selected. And in the tournament, we extract on a random basis a set of k individuals, and then we deterministically select the best individual among the tournament. So these three different selection mechanisms are used to create a subpopulation, which is then recombined using a crossover mechanism. So we take two random individuals from the selected individuals, and then we exchange the structures on the individuals in order to create some new offsprings. Basically, what we do, for instance, in single point crossover, is to cut in a random position the individuals and exchange the structures among the two parents to create new offspring that are then perturbed using mutation. So we change some of the values in the structure of our individuals, and then we obtain a new population of offspring, or mutated offspring, that replace the former population, and then we iterate the process. A third methodology is evolution strategy, which is again an evolutionary methodology, and it's based on mutation, adaptation, and selection. As you can see, we don't have an explicit crossover mechanism in basic evolution strategy. So the mutation mechanism, which is the core of evolution strategy, takes a solution, Xi, and then it adds a vector of random number, sampled generally from a normal distribution, with a user-defined standard deviation, which takes the name of mutation strength. So we are basically taking each individual, and we are perturbing the positions of each individual using a multivariate normal distributions. Some advanced methods dynamically are able to dynamically adapt the mutation strength in order to optimally explore the search space. And in state-of-the-art methods, we can have a mutation strength that is parameter-specific, and it can detect the correlations between parameters in order to rotate the search space and more effectively perturb the individuals along the following the correlations between parameters. I will explain this concept with an example. So in the first figure on the left, we have classic evolution strategies. So we have, as you can see, a bivariate normal distribution with the same mutation strength. This is naturally not optimal because we can have different sensitivity for the two different parameters, so maybe we want to use a different strength for different parameters. And this is exactly what happens in the second figure in the center. But sometimes the fitness improves when both explore the search space in not just in one parameter but two parameters simultaneously. So for instance, in this case we increase the quality of the individuals increases as long as we increase both kinetic parameters in both directions. So in order to do that, we need to calculate the covariances of our data and try to rotate the search space and use a different mutation strength in the rotated space. This is exactly what covariance matrix adaptation evolution strategy does. There are two main versions of evolution strategy from the point of view of selection mechanism. One is called mu, lambda, and one is called mu plus lambda. So in the first version, we create lambda new individuals out of a population of mu individuals, and then we pick up the best mu individuals among lambda to create a new population. In the second methodology, we create mu lambda individuals, but now we will create an intermediate population using the parents and the offsprings, and then on this subpopulation we pick up mu individuals to create the new population. There are also more complicated formulations, but basically these are the two that are used in the literature. Finally, we have a particle swarm optimization, and it's the only swarm intelligence methodology that I will describe in this talk, and it's a meta heuristic based on the emergent behavior of groups of fish and birds. According to the paper that I showed before, particle swarm optimization is the most feasible methodology for parameter estimation, and this is why we leverage PSO for our job. In PSO, particles represent the candidate solutions to a problem, and they move inside a bounded search space in m dimensions. So we have m parameters, we have m dimensions. And each particle in PSO is characterized by two vectors. We have a vector xi, which is the position that is the putative solution for our problem, and the vector v, which is the velocity of particles during the optimization. The velocity is used to update the particle's position in the search space. So each particle is placed in a position x, and then we use the new velocity v to move the particles and iteratively move the particle inside the search space. Naturally, the velocity changes in time, and it changes according to true attraction. So each particle is attracted using a social and a cognitive attraction. Let's see a scheme to understand the function in PSO. We have the current position of the particle, and then we have the current velocity. Then we have the social attraction, which is the best position found by the swarm so far. Then we have the cognitive attraction, which is the best position found by the particle itself so far. So the particle is torn, the particle is attracted from both, in both directions, and then we calculate a sum of these attractions plus a little bit of inertia with respect to the previous iteration. This gives the new velocity, which is used to calculate the new positions of the particle, and the process iterates. So when the user wants to use PSO, he must set multiple settings. For instance, the strength of the social factor, which modulates the attraction towards the global best, the strength of the cognitive factor, which modulates the attraction towards the personal best, the inertia weight, which balances the aforementioned settings, so it makes a higher or lower inertia of the velocity, then we need to choose the size of the swarm, we need to choose the maximum, if we want, velocity of the particles, and the minimum velocity of the particles. Moreover, we need to handle the particles that go outside the search space, for instance, negative kinetic parameters, which have no sense, and then we need to choose an algorithm for the initial distribution of particles. So we have to carefully craft these settings, and Dreger underlines this in his paper, because they have a relevant impact on the optimization. And this is generally annoying for people without expertise. This is exactly why we created Fuzzy Self-2 in PSO, Fast PSO, it's the name, which is a settings-free alternative to classic PSO. The idea of Fast PSO is to equip each particle with a fuzzy logic reasoner, which is able to adapt the behavior of the particle according to its performances. So you can see here on the right, the surface is created using two metrics, and each surface determines the new value for the inertia, for the social, for the cognitive factors, for the lowest velocity and the highest velocity. And for instance, here we can say, okay, the particle is doing better with respect to the previous iteration, and it's very far from the global best. In such a case, we want to be, it's red, as you can see, inertia is red, which means that the inertia is extremely high. So the idea, the rationale, is that we want a high inertia when we are doing good. So we are far from the global best, and we are improving our fitness, so we want to let the particle go. And these kind of ideas are cabled, were introduced into fuzzy rules, and they determine the dynamic behavior of the system. So we created this methodology, and we tested that on 40 shifter and rotated benchmark functions, and we saw that our methodology largely outperforms classic PSO, artificial B-colony, differential evolution, and genetic algorithms. We are competitive with respect to covariance matrix adaptation evolution strategy, but we are way more computationally efficient. We want to stress the fact that our method is also a very simple and straightforward Python API, and it was also designed to easily implement the distributed and parallel fitness evaluations. And also, it's also easy to install, because it's now on the PyPI repository, so you can just pip install this library, and it's in less than 1 second, you're done. So these are some results of FastPSO. We compared its performances with the previously described algorithms, and as you can see, we are generally tied to CMAES, so even better, with the notable exception of functions characterized by plateaus. In such a case, the fuzzy reasoner gets confused and the performances are worse. But in the other cases, we are always the best or the second best algorithm across the state of the art. Naturally, all the methodologies that I described so far are computationally intensive, because they are population-based algorithms. So for each generation, we require hundreds of fitness evaluations, and we repeat the evaluations for all the iterations of the algorithms. It can easily end up with millions of simulations that are generally sequentially executed, leading to very long running times. For this reason, we need some kind of alternative architecture to perform the simulations. And since all the fitness evaluations during the single generation are mutually independent, we can leverage high-performance computing, for instance, clusters of computers, to distribute the fitness evaluations and strongly reduce the running time. We can also parallelize a single fitness evaluation if we can distribute the computation that are needed to perform that simulation. So there are multiple high-performance computing architectures, and among the others, we focused on GPUs because they have some advantages. For instance, they are local, so we don't need to move our data to another computer across the internet, for instance. They are relatively cheap, they are very power efficient, they are pervasive, so every computer has a GPUs nowadays. They are massively multi-core, giving access to terascale performances. So we focused on GPUs for our implementations, and this is one example of what we did in the past. So LASSIE is a fine-grained large-scale simulator, which means that we use the GPU to distribute the calculation of a single simulation, that is a single fitness evaluation, and using thousands of cores, we can simulate models that are thousands reactions or thousands chemical species big. Our method is adaptive, so it's able to deal with stiff systems, and as you can see, using simulating very large scale models, we can end up with approximately 90 times speed up with respect to the CPU. We also created coarse grain simulators in order to distribute multiple simulations on a GPU, and this is an example of a stochastic coarse grain simulator based on tau leaping. It's highly optimized, and so we obtain a very big speed up for small models and approximately 25 times speed up for complex models like the pathway that we are administrating here. And 25 times, it means that you can reduce to a matter of a few hours what generally required more than 1 month. Finally, we also implemented a coarse-grain deterministic simulator based on LSODA. So again, this algorithm is able to deal with stiffness in the system by switching between implicit and explicit integration. And CapSODA is very optimized for high-performance computing memories, and this allowed us to reach approximately 80 times fast acceleration with respect to the CPU, which means 8 hours instead of 1 month. So, how can we put everything together? This is an example of how FastPSO can be combined to CapSODA to perform settings-free and GPU power parameter estimation. This is the whole source code that is needed to perform such a simulation. So the first step is just importing stuff. So we import FastPSO, NumPy, subprocess to launch CapSODA, and PyLab, which is needed to plot the results. Then we need to create two variables in order to point to CapSODA and to point to the model that we want to investigate. After that, we have to implement the fitness function that will be assigned to FastPSO. The fitness function basically must accept a list of lists which describes the population. So we have a list of the positions of the particles, and then it must return the vector of the fitness evaluation. This is how CapSODA is launched. So we need to specify the binary executable file, a path to the model, how many blocks we want to use, and some numbers that specify the GPU that we want to use, the kind of fitness evaluation, and so forth. Naturally, before we can perform the simulation, we need to create the matrix of the parameterization we want to test, and that's it. This is the actual parameter estimation code. We create a FastPSO instance. We set the search space, we set the swarm size, we assign the fitness function that we just created, and then we can perform this in the optimization using Solvay FastPSO. This is the number of iterations that we want. We can set any number we want. And this is the kind of initialization of the particles. In this case, it's logarithmic. Finally, we have some service functions we need. For instance, we need a function that tells to CapSODA where are the time series that we want to use for the fitness evaluation, and a few additional files that will describe the initial conditions of the system. And then finally, we can plot the results. So in conclusion, we argue that dynamic models are the most likely candidates to comprehend the several processes. However, we need parameters to perform simulation of such systems, and we need some robust parameter estimation methodology to get those parameters. Although our evolutionary computation and swarm intelligence are very efficient approaches, they are computationally expensive, and this is why we are leveraging GPUs in our work to strongly reduce the running time of the methodologies. And we also created a novel PSO algorithm, which is completely settings-free and can be easily combined with GPU power simulators in order to pave the way to settings-free and efficient parameter estimation. We also created tools like LASSIE that are able to simulate very large biochemical models, so we use a GPU to accelerate a single simulation. However, such models hardly have parameters. It's difficult. We can measure 10,000 parameters at once. So the classic methodologies for parameter estimation are probably unfit for the problem. So we need to create some novel large-scale parameter estimation methodology to deal with such systems and to analyze those systems. And we also want to create hybrid simulation methodology, because now we have to choose between deterministic and stochastic simulation, and we want to create something that is able to separate the reactions in different regimes and use the for those regimes the correct simulation method. We also want to kick in some additional formalism. For instance, we want to combine flux balance analysis and fuzzy logic into our models in order to create a general purpose, completely general and large-scale simulation method. So I want to finish my presentation, to conclude, by thanking again Jorge Garrapiras for the kind invitation. I want to thank my collaborators, Giancarlo, Gabriella, Dani, Paolo Tango, Leo e Ottavio. And finally, I want to thank you for your attention. Do you have any questions?